Prime Minister there addressing the BJP Karyakartas at the BJP headquarters in Delhi after the big result came out today from Karnataka. We've had a very, very big day as Karnataka's election results were tallied and were counted. It's been a roller coaster. By about 12 o'clock this afternoon, everyone felt the BJP had won. The BJP had the largest numbers. All the leads pointed towards the BJP. Our experts in the studio, though, kept reminding us that things could change at any moment, like they always do. And the analogy that we kept going back to was a T20 cricket match that could change at any point. And change it did. Towards the end of the day, we saw the Congress and the JDS come together, form an alliance, which we realized they had been working on for the last 4 days on every possible scenario. They had formed the alliance, they moved to the governor's house, and they asked for permission to form the government. Not to be left behind, although the BJP had found itself at the loss for a strategy, because several hours after the JDS and the Congress announced their alliance, the BJP still didn't have a plan. Yediyurappa then, after speaking with members of BJP High Command, moved to the governor's house to ask for permission to form the government himself. To just give you an idea of where the numbers are, viewers, they're on your screen, they're on the bottom of your screen. The BJP has 104 seats. The Congress and the JDS have 78 and 38, taking them up collectively to 116. They also, from what we understand, have the two independents as well. That takes them up to 118. So here's the big question that everybody is going to want to answer. The governor of Karnataka has kept us all guessing. He hasn't told us which one of the two options he's picked and given the right to form the government first, or to prove their numbers first at least. So should he be picking the party with the most number of seats, which would be the BJP, the single largest party but still short of the halfway mark? Or should he be picking the coalition that crosses the halfway mark, which would be the Congress and the JDS plus and the independents? That's the question we're asking. Of course, remember, this is exactly what the BJP had done in two separate occasions with Goa and with Manipur. So right now, the tables have turned on the BJP and they're arguing against their previous arguments from earlier last year. Joining me on the show today, Vineet Goenka for the BJP, Priyanka Chaturvedi for the Congress, Sangeet Kumar Raghi is a political analyst, Urmilesh is a senior journalist joining us in Delhi, Mr. Kailash Vasudev is a senior advocate with the Supreme Court, Kamal Mitra Chinoy is a professor of political science, Siddharth Bhatia, founding editor of The Wire, very senior journalist, and Vineet Tiwari, senior consulting editor with The Times Network. I thank all of you for giving us your time. The idea really here is to help our audience understand what the problem is and why is this taking so long to figure out. Opening statements from all of our guests, but I will start with the political guests. Priyanka Chaturvedi, I'm going to start with you. Of course, there was a lot being said in the middle of the day that the Congress is down and out, that you've lost your that you lost your last most important state. A bounce back from that. But I want you to respond to what the BJP is saying, that you don't have the mandate of the people, so why are you forming the government?
Actually, that's a false narrative that the BJP is trying to spread because it suits their purpose. If you go and see the vote share that the Congress has happened to get is 7 lakhs more than what BJP has got. So that in itself tells a different story. The people of Karnataka have voted for the Congress. However, it has not turned into seat wins for us. And secondly, I would like to mention here, BJP would, it suits their purpose by trying to spread this entire idea of Congress not getting the mandate of the people. In fact, if the Congress and the JDS have gone up to the governor and said, we amongst ourselves, we wish to form a coalition government and run the government of Karnataka in Karnataka, but we don't have the governor responding to us, even if it has emerged as the single largest party, it does not enjoy the confidence of other political parties to align with it. And this is where the problem with the BJP is. In other states like Mizoram, in Meghalaya, Goa, we have seen how they did not emerge as the single largest party, but they went on to form the governments. If we use the same standards, then the Congress and the JDS need to be invited to form the government. And that is how the norm works. And if we go by the Supreme Court decision recently on the Goa government formation, that is how the norm works. So BJP might try to mislead the people of this nation. However, people of Karnataka have emphatically chosen to vote for the Congress, and the vote share in itself speaks a lot.
Priyanka Chaturvedi, tell us what the latest is from inside the Congress right now with the coalition and with the conversation with the governor. What was it? Where was it left? When will the governor get back to the members of the party who had spoken with him?
No, our senior leaders approached the governor and assured their support to the JDS in totality, and we also proposed the chief minister to be HD Kumaraswamy, and the governor has said that he would consult other experts on this and get back to us. But if you go by the norm, and the norm that has been followed since 2014, the norms would say that it is the Bharatiya Janata Party might have emerged as the single largest party, but okay, the numbers are definitely with the BJP, with the Congress and the JDS.
Vinit Goenka, do you want to respond to that?
Well, there are two situations. One where the largest holding of the MLAs, that is BJP, should be called for forming the government. Another, what the Congress representative said. But I think here, BJP has a clear mark. It has got 104 seats compared to the 40 which was in the last election, whereas Congress has come down from 122 to the 78. So the mandate has gone to BJP. People have chosen BJP over Congress. So I think BJP has all the legitimate rights. And let us wait for the governor to come back and tell us what he actually wants.
All right, I'm going to open this up to my panel right now because I want everybody to weigh in on this decision. Mr. Kailash Vasudev hasn't joined us yet, but Siddharth Bhatia, given the laws as they stand right now, what should the governor be doing? Should he be looking at forming the government as fast as possible, returning, you know, creating a government for the state so the state can continue to move on? Because this process could take a really long time.
Well, there's the laws and there's convention. Mm-hmm. And as far as I know, the Bommai judgment clearly says that he has to call the most tenable arrangement in his judgment. Also, don't forget the a far bigger constitutional expert than I am, Mr. Arun Jaitley, mm-hmm. in Manipur in March 2017, clearly said that, you yes. know, if the governor is satisfied that there is a combination which can put together a stable majority government, he has to call them. So, as I said, convention, the law, and Goa has been invoked, and that happened almost suddenly. Mm-hmm. But in the end, nobody contested it on constitutional grounds. Let's not yes. forget that. People talked about morality and things, but nobody said, you know, this is constitutionally wrong. So we don't know what the governor is thinking. He might be tempted to say, I'll call somebody, Mr. Yedurappa has said, call me on the floor and I'll prove it within 3 days or 2 days or whatever. But he might be thinking to say, I'll go in this direction or that. But he'll have to really justify his decision. And I think that's going to be a bit tricky because whatever his instincts are, he'll have to come up with a constitutional justification for this.
And just to read out what some members of the BJP said in reaction to the Manipur and the Goa cases, Mr. Venkaiah Naidu said, Goa and Manipur, no party has absolute majority. Other parties have come forward to form the government with BJP. They've selected their leaders. They've approached the respective governors to form governments. There's
absolutely
nothing wrong with
the
it.
Same case.
Yes. Mr. Arun Jaitley said, they're falsely accusing the BJP of stealing the mandate. It's not stealing the mandate if your coalition has the numbers, Vinay?
Yes, and I think most of the independent and neutral legal experts, people who understand constitutional law, when we spoke to them earlier in the day, I think all of them are fairly unanimous in the fact that in the current situation, the governor's constitutional responsibility is to ensure that an elected government is put in place as quickly as possible after an election happens. In that situation, he has to take a decision on which of the existing, in the absence of a clear verdict for one person, who is it who is in the best position to form a government? Is there any possibility or not? In the current scenario, that possibility does exist because you do have two parties who've come together formally and now publicly saying that we are together, and they're ostensibly giving it in writing. In this scenario, the governor really has no option but to invite them to prove the majority on the floor of the House. In the event that he doesn't do that, we are almost looking at a situation where the governor is actually constitutionally allowing a party to break another party to form a government.
Because that's the only way to make
That's the only way the BJP can get more than 104 that they have.
Yeah, yes. Break or abstain or whatever, but it will be quite, bending propriety.
That would be a wise thing for the governor to do, to actually say take 7 days or take 8 days, because that will create room for negotiation and for trading, which
we don't want. Unfortunately, the law doesn't really specify the period of time. But yes, if the governor does give any party a week or more than a week to prove, you are obviously encouraging horse trading, because why else would you need 1 week?
Apparently, the JDS MLAs have been already shipped off to an undisclosed location. So there is a resort somewhere that has a long-term booking.
What you can see from here is that there was a lot of planning behind the scenes for the last few days, because resorts must have been booked. People must have been told.
So here's the question. Does this qualify as a pre-poll alliance or a post-poll alliance?
Post-poll alliance.
Post-poll alliance.
All right. Yeah. Because there is a mandate with that as well. The pre-poll alliance, as per the rule, should gain more importance than a post-poll alliance.
No, but I think the Sarkare Commission or whatever, which states that, but that becomes relevant only when the governor is confronted with a situation that there is no possibility of a government being formed in the normal situation. He has to go by the precedence of single party, pre-poll alliance, and then post-poll alliance, in that order.
All right, Urmilesh ji, aapko kya lagta hai?
Yeah, nahi, aaj ki jo sthiti hai, jo result samne hai, usme ek baat bilkul saaf hai ki Bharatiya Janata Party single largest party hai, largest single party hai. लेकिन 104 के आगे उसको जो 8 सीटें और जरूरत है, इन 8 सीटों का वो अरेंजमेंट कहां से करेगी, इसके बारे में उसके पास कोई जवाब नहीं है अभी तक. पहली बात. दूसरी बात यह है कि जो इंडिपेंडेंट जीते हैं, वो दो इंडिपेंडेंट हैं जिसमें अभी तक जो संकेत हैं कि वो दोनों संभवतः कांग्रेस जेडीएस के साथ जा रहे हैं. अब सवाल यह है कि 8 सीट अगर आपके पास नहीं है असेंबली में, और जेडीएस के पास और कांग्रेस के पास 116 प्लस 2 इसकी संभावना है, यानी कुल मिलाकर 118. अगर हम मानकर चलें कि बीजेपी को राज्यपाल महोदय, चूंकि मिलने का उन्होंने सबसे पहले मौका बीजेपी को दिया है, तो वो ठीक है, उनका अधिकार है, लेकिन कांग्रेस और जेडीएस के डेलीगेशन को उन्होंने मौका नहीं दिया मिलने का. तो ये पहला एक इंडिकेशन है कि कहीं ना कहीं एक आग्रह पूर्वाग्रह दिखाई दे रहा है. अभी हमारे मित्र सिद्धार्थ भाटिया ने उन्हें कोट भी किया अरुण जेटली को, मणिपुर के कॉन्टेक्स्ट में, और गोवा में जो हुआ था पिछली दफा वो भी हम सब जानते हैं. मुझे लगता है कि ऐसी सिचुएशन में राज्यपाल को पहले काम जो करना चाहिए था वो बीजेपी के नेताओं और कांग्रेस जेडीएस के नेताओं दोनों को सुनना, और सुनने के बाद अपने विवेक से फैसला करना, जो संविधान ने उनको प्रदत्त किया है अधिकार, कि वो कौन सरकार चला सकता है और सरकार कौन चला सकता है, गिवन सिचुएशन में बिल्कुल क्लियर है. अगर इसका वो पालन नहीं करते हैं तो मुझे लगता है कि ये कर्नाटक में एक गहरा संकट पैदा करेगा, और हॉर्स ट्रेडिंग के लिए जाहिर है ये एक माहौल
बनाएगा. To the BJP. So even if Yediyurappa has said that he will give me a chance, I will form my government, where does he plan to bring these 8 extra seats from? He can't take them out of the JDS, he can't take them out of the Congress, the independents and the BSP are not available. So what is he going to do? What is the plan, Vinit Goenka?
So let me explain to you what is the process, which I understand it, and anybody else can correct me if I'm wrong. The first is the swearing in of all this member of legislative assemblies in the assembly. The second step will be selecting the speaker, which itself will be a challenge because there will be candidates from both the sides. Once the speaker is done, then the claim for the government will be there, and the real test lies on the floor. If you see all the rulings which are there in Supreme Court and otherwise also, the floor of the test is the ultimate test for selecting the government. And I believe that people who have elected good MLAs from all the sides would vote for BJP government in Karnataka.
But Mr. Goenka, if both parties have issued whips, how can the party members who are now under a whip go against the party whip?
You can't vote against your party.
Also, the people have already voted, so that's not irrelevant now.
See, I'm not very sure, but I don't think a whip is issued when there is a voting going on.
Let us wait and watch.
I don't have an answer right now.
In a confidence motion, the whip will be issued. You have to flip. If somebody has to prove the majority in the floor of the house, a whip will be issued. That's standard practice.
Priyanka Chaturvedi.
There will be good MLAs. There will be good MLAs both in Congress as well as in JDA.
You are saying, hang on, you're saying, Mr. Ved Goenkar, that there will be MLAs within the Congress and the JDS who will vote for the BJP, who will vote to put a BJP government.
There will be good MLAs.
Is that what you're saying?
No, that's, I don't know what he's talking about. I'm sorry.
We'll have to wait and see.
This is not how the process works. I don't know. He just needs to look at. I'm sorry. I will have to interject here because that is not how it works. The process is that the governor needs to be convinced that one particular party that he invites to form the government has enough number of seats to claim their stake at forming a government. And very categorically, right now, the Bharatiya Janata Party doesn't seem to have it. It is the second and the third largest party which have it, which have gone with numbers, which have gone with letters of support to the governor. And it becomes, he is duty bound constitutionally, and as per the words of right from Arun Jaitley to Mr. Amit Shah to the Supreme Court, to every recent decisions that have happened in the past state government formation, whether it's a two-seat Bharatiya Janata Party is taking a claim of forming a government in Meghalaya, or a second largest party in Goa, second largest party in Manipur, forming a government in various states. So this is how it should be working. The governor should be looking at both sides of the claims, single largest party, whether they can cobble up a majority, and the other parties which are showing support to each other and talking about forming the government. That is how it is invited, and that is how then you will have a floor test. No one can select two speakers. That does not happen. That is not how the process works. The party which has claimed that they have the support will be invited to form the government, and that is what the governor is duty bound to do and constitutionally is authorized to do.
Well, also Vidit Goenkar suggesting that members of the Congress and the JDS will vote for the BJP seems
some
rather
good,
What does that mean, Vidit Goenkar?
BJP MLAs might vote for the Congress and JDS coalition. They may not vote for their own party. Rather than them hoping that someone else would skip to their party, it could be the other way around also. And we know that there are over 12 MLAs from the Bharatiya Janata Party who have reached out to the BJP, to the Congress and the JDS.
Priyanka, are you talking about horse trading too?
But as of now, even without any cross... No, I'm not talking about any horse trading. I'm talking about a simple majority.
Can I answer this question?
The Congress and JDS have...
Can I answer this question?
We have the strength. We have taken it to the governor. It is for the governor to take a call between... Sir, we don't need to get into horse trading. Operation Kamala is your signature style. It is not Congress's style. The Manipur style is your style where you'll buy out people. This is how you all work. We don't work like that. We are working within the constitutional norms provided to us, and we have both taken letters of support. We have gone to the governor and said that this is a simple majority situation and allow us to form the government. And that is what
right.
the process
I want to remind our viewers that the governor has not chosen one over the other. So there should be, for the time being, no question on the intentions of the governor at all. He's consulting, and he said he will give us his decision. Kailash Vasudev joins us right now. Mr. Vasudev, thank you for joining us. The legal point of view, please, Mr. Vasudev, on what this means and what the governor ought to do. There's no specification from what we understand on the time limit. Should or can the governor give them a week, 2 weeks, 10 days? There's no specification. But which way legally should the governor go? The party with the largest numbers, short of majority, or the coalition that provides the majority?
Conventionally, it is the party with the largest number which is invited to prove its majority on the floor of the House.
Okay.
The governor may specify time, it's his discretion, a week, 48 hours or whatever. But by convention, it's the party with the largest number of MLAs or MPs which is invited to form the government. If the party fails to prove the majority, then it is the discretion
that
of the governor
untrue.
To call upon other parties to form a coalition or make a representation to go ahead
untrue.
And form the government.
Right,
but initially, it has to be the party with the largest number of votes.
All right. Kamal Mitra Chinoy disagrees with you. Professor Chinoy, go ahead, please.
Number one, there has been a Bommai judgment upheld by the Supreme Court. And it has said that the majority should be shown in the floor of the House. It is not the case, I repeat, not the case that the single largest party is asked to form government. What is asked by the Speaker and should be ratified by the Governor is a vote in the Assembly and the coalition or party which has the largest number of votes under the Bommai judgment gets to form the government. It's a very clear decision of the Supreme Court, and it antedates all these other decisions, predates all the other decisions.
1994 Supreme Court.
Mr. Vasudev?
1994 Supreme Court. Well, I couldn't hear the gentleman. The audio had gone. Please repeat the question.
Professor Kamal Mitra Roy said that what you said was wrong. He disagreed with you. He said that the Bommai judgment of the Supreme Court that very clearly states that the coalition with the largest numbers, not the single party, anyone with the largest numbers should be invited to form the government.
You see, Bommai's judgment came in the context of the declaration of
inside
the
assembly.
Of the states.
Hmm.
But subsequently, that's right. Inside the assembly is after the first offer has to be given to the party with the maximum number of things. Otherwise, you're defeating the democratic process. The purpose of an election is to have a party with a maximum number of votes. So you give them an opportunity, failing which you come to the situation where the coalition comes into the power. It's a standard practice all over. Otherwise, you're defeating the entire purpose of an election. Supreme Court does not specifically say first you'll call upon the minorities to form a government in coalition with one another. Nowhere in Bommai does it say that in specific terms. That's the second option.
Well, I just want to point out that
that's
currently at Hotel Ashoka, Gulam Nabi Azad, Ashok Gelot, Mallikarjun Kharge, Dinesh Gundurao,
they get the right. That's not true.
Yes, and several other high-level Congress members are having a meeting, including D.K. Shivkumar, who is in talks with the independents and with JDS. So things are still moving on the ground in Karnataka. There still seems to be some movement. Vineet Goenka, go ahead. And I also want to bring in Sangeet Kumar Raghi. Vineet, respond, and then I'll bring in Sangeet.
What I believe is the governor actually also takes advices from many various quarters of the society. They take advices from constitutional experts also. I am sure the Karnataka governor is taking the advice. He is going to go through the process and then invite an appropriate party. As rightly said by the previous panelist, it is the single largest party who should be invited in this particular case. Congress has lost miserably there in Karnataka, coming down from 122 to 78. Also, does the JDU has lost from 40 to 38. I think that two indicators, and the entire half of the cabinet has been lost. If you see stalwarts like Santosh Lad, H.K. Patil, Mahadevappa, and Siddaramaiah also lost in one of the seats. Now, these all are the symptoms where the Congress has lost its face there in Karnataka. I think it will be appropriate for governor to invite BJP and let the BJP prove their majority on the floor of the House.
You know, but the question does arise that the incumbent government in Goa was voted out, clearly voted out. Mm. They had less seats than the winner of the single largest party of the Congress. And there were there was a party with three people, Vijay Sardesai and two others, who had clearly said there is no way they will ever go with the BJP. That was their pitch.
Yes.
And overnight, those three went to the BJP, which had lost the election.
Yes.
And then formed the party. So in that case, it was a very nimble, politically savvy act.
So none of the arguments that Vineet Goenka is offering right now, that you lost the mandate, you've lost a lot, you've lost desperately, unfortunately, all of those things also apply to the BJP in Goa, Vineet Goenka. So you're putting yourself actually in a corner at this point because you're arguing against yourself.
We will have to see Karnataka. Ms. Faye, we will have to see Karnataka today. And in the case of Karnataka, 104.
So you're saying let's conveniently forget about Goa and Manipur and only look at Karnataka as a special case.
Why do we have to? No. It was an independent decision of the governor there.
No,
I would also request, if I'm there in Karnataka, I would have also requested the governor to give us a chance to do that.
No, but it sets a precedent, right? If the government of India has decided to, if the ruling party in India has decided to go down that route, it sets a precedent. Let me bring in
Sangeet.
Priyanka, go ahead, please.
It's our right to stick, and it is also correct on behalf of the governor to give us an opportunity to form a government, and then let us prove that majority.
So, by that argument, isn't it also the Congress and the JDS is right to stake claim to the government?
On what basis do you get the right? You're a minority party.
In Goa, the incumbent chief minister lost his He lost his seat in Goa. The incumbent chief minister lost his seat. They also lost.
Today we'll have to talk about Karnataka, madam. Come out of Goa and Mizoram, please.
On the other hand, Ari, why should
each
I not go?
Each election is different, madam. Each election is different.
Because that's not the turning point for India's democracy. And you all use constitutional norms.
I can understand your frustration, madam, but I can understand your frustration. But you have to understand the reality of politics.
What frustration are you talking about? Frustration is with you people.
I'm talking about
you
reality.
People.
You have lost.
Modi doing
you have lost miserably.
Also in Karnataka.
All right.
Cannot end up getting your majority in Karnataka. Cannot even live up to the expectations that he got for people of Karnataka in 2014.
I like your
speech for your
opinion. Okay, not at the same time, please. We need going up, Priyanka Chaturvedi. You all are speaking over each other and we can't understand you.
We have more votes than the Bharatiya Janata Party. We okay. have increased our four
ma'am,
votes.
People have given
I
us mandate.
What you
and
all right, all right,
that.
All right.
Let,
I have one more guest who hasn't spoken.
We
Sangeet Kumar Raghi
yes,
has
they
not
have
spoken.
Given a mandate.
Priyanka,
and
one
the
moment,
mandate
please.
Is that the second and the third largest
okay,
party will
okay.
form a government.
Okay. Thank you. Sangeet Kumar Raghi, go ahead.
Look, I find very interesting interpretation by the Congress spokesperson and the other panelists. There are three issues. Number one, interpretation of the mandate. Second, who should be invited to form the government. And third, whether the governor has followed the convention in this regard or not. Coming to the first question, you know, we always find that the when political parties lose the election, they would always be talking in terms of the percentage of the votes that they have got. But when they win the election, they will be always talking in terms of the number of seats that they have got. JDS primarily, got the seats against the Congress party. If we look at the entire six regions in Karnataka. So a party which was 123 and got reduced to 78 is saying that the mandate is in favor of the party. It's something
no,
which
but,
is
but,
oxymoron. It doesn't
Sangeet Kumar
nice
Raghi,
at all.
I don't believe the Congress at any point
please,
said the mandate
please,
was in their favor.
I listen to please hold on. I listen to all of you six panelists. You know, I waited for my turn. So please don't interrupt. Second round. As far as convention is concerned in the entire parliamentary democracy in the world, what the constitutional head does is that if he is convinced, even in the constitution it is written, usually, the word has been made usually. Secondly, let me tell you that the governor has got discretionary power under Article 167 of the constitution, which even the president of India hasn't got. Remember this fact. And the governor, if it finds that this coalition or that formation is going to give a stable government, it is within the parliamentary norms to invite the leader of that party to form the government. And Venkat Chelaiah Commission, Sarkaria Commission, and coming to the Bombay case, it is within the right, actually the settled principle is that the majority has not to be tested in the Raj Bhavan. It has to be tested on the floor of the house. Fourth point, I'm talking to, I will be commenting on Priyanka, that she should not forget about the Ayaram Gayabaram politics, which was introduced in the Indian politics by none other but the Congress party. Bhajan Lal Mandil must remember that it was the, defection.
How about self-serving politics of Narendra Modi and Amit Shah? Let's discuss that. Let's talk about current times. Let's talk about
the history
that you are making.
All right.
It is your party, ma'am. Please hold on.
Why should I?
One second. Please, not at the same time. Priyanka, allow him to finish and then you can respond.
I didn't intercept when you were speaking. So please listen to me carefully. So don't have a moral high ground. You know what the Yuvaraj has done in Congress in Karnataka today. I think that your Yuvaraj has become liability on your party. Think about that. And today nobody is talking about whether there was the day before yesterday there was a comparison between Rahul Gandhi and Narendra Modi. Who is the charismatic leadership? I had made this point on this channel only. That the Congress president has to prove his leadership. The Congress president has to prove his credential as a leader.
Okay, all right. So, Sissy, let's stick to the point. I don't want to get into the conversation of who has a more charismatic leader.
Let's talk about the Karnataka leadership. I haven't heard any single BJP member coming forward.
All right, so we're going to have to break this up for a second. I just want to focus on the problem at hand. Which is which way would the government go and who would form a government in Karnataka? Now, remember, every day that is spent without a government is bad for the state. So it is in the general interest of the people in the state that this problem gets solved as quickly as possible. You know, in Karnataka, we have a saying, it says, Yeradara jangla mooranige lava, which means that when two people fight, the third person will always profit. And in this case, that third person turns out to be H.T. Kumaraswamy, who has turned out to be both king and kingmaker and has managed to use the 38 seats that he has to put himself in a very, very good position.
Yes, but look.
I have a small point to make. Just few seconds. Congress did it in Jharkhand. The Congress has been reduced to third force in Jharkhand. Congress did it in Uttar Pradesh, where Congress party is today in Uttar Pradesh, everybody knows. So I think that
sir,
I would be suggesting that it
will be bad reduced to two seats
party.
Perhaps in the center. With the kind of politics you all are spreading across the nation.
All right, let's
perhaps
go back to my question.
One second.
You know what? You know, I'll tell you what. I know that this Congress versus BJP fight can go on all night. I also know that Sangeet Kumar Ragi, who comes in as a political analyst, has now rendered Vineet Goenka completely redundant as a BJP spokesperson because you've taken on the role and he barely has anything left to do. But I want to talk about Kumaraswamy and how Kumaraswamy at this point might be the next chief minister of Karnataka. Vineet?
Yeah, look, I mean, just to go slightly back, I think this constant bickering between rival political formations, Congress, BJP and whoever else is doing it is, look, it's all heat and no light, and I don't think that's really what viewers or anybody looks for. I think the substantive point, which was made by Kailash Vasudev, the only rebuttal that I have to this, which I think Amalmitra Chinoy mentioned a little bit, is both, there are precedences of both types that exist in the governor's conduct insofar as asking for a
Correct.
Political formation tonight. So let's not deny that both precedences exist.
Correct.
It's not true that only the largest party is to be invited. Correct. There are enough precedences in the past where it has not been invited.
Yes. Correct.
So now the current question and the only relevant question is that this particular governor is now faced with a similar dilemma where none of the parties have a majority. The single largest party is falling short by almost 12 seats. Does he do that risky thing of calling something with President X or does he take a safer option of doing the other thing, which is President Y? That's the only question right now. How long he takes to make up his mind and consult the experts and how long, as you rightly said, Faye, which is far, far more important a question, can you have a state in a sense of uncertainty and without governance is a much bigger issue than all this bickering that is going on between the past and all this
Let's also point
calling.
Out that there is a lot at stake for all three parties in question. And so it's very likely that the party against, you know, the party who finds the judgment going against themselves are likely to approach the courts and bring in the judiciary, which will make this fight a much longer fight. Kailash Vasudev, is that likely that the judiciary will be brought in, you know, in this case? Because I can't imagine either of these parties walking away saying, okay, it went against us.
You see, what is worrisome is this. Yes, judicial review will have to be called for at some point of time. Somebody will go to court. It has happened in Jharkhand. It has happened in Uttarakhand of late. It happened in the northeastern states where the Supreme Court was knocked around for the purposes of bringing back a government which had been removed by the governor. But that apart, today, you see, what is getting a bit more a matter of great concern is parties are not coming in by majority. You are having coalitions which are running governments over here with combinations between one party and another, unknown parties and known parties. The ramifications of that is there is no good governance. There is a fear that if the other chappy walks out, my government is going to fall. So you have to do a policy of appeasement. Moment you have a policy of appeasement, the policy of appeasement defeats the very essentials of good governance. The anxiety by the common man, I'll raise it for myself. If I have a stable government, I know there'll be good governance. If there's an unstable government, I know there'll be trouble all the way through. You'll have financial difficulties, you'll have planning difficulties, you'll have a government which cannot work sensibly. This happened in the first round, if you recall, when Atal Bihari Vajpayee came in 13 days, he unfortunately lost out for one vote. Today we have a situation where nobody is in power or nobody is in majority. What is going to be the consequence thereof? The whole system has once again got to be looked at. Democracy is superb. We do not have a wider, more vibrant democracy than the Indian democracy. But in democracy, there's got to be good governance. At this rate, we're not going to have it. The BJP will pull one way, the Congress will pull one way, the JDS will pull the other way. Two independents will be playing around for themselves because everybody's looking at his authority in running governments as per what he thinks is right, not having the majority. That's the problem.
Well, a fractured mandate is always a problem. And like Vinay predicted this morning, this is bad news for the state itself.
That's right.
Right. Vineet Goyka, go ahead, please.
That's right.
Yeah, Faye, as you know, I'll have to leave. So I'll just say two simple lines and then say this major, the mandate which has come is clearly for BJP. Congress has been defeated in Karnataka. We will wait for governor's decision. And I'm very sure we will win the test on the floor. Ultimately, the test is on the floor, not in the court or not in the governor's
house. But Vineet, you still haven't answered the question of where will the eight extra seats come from? Where will the eight extra votes come from for that test that you are so confident about?
You'll have to wait and watch. You'll have to wait and watch, right? You'll have to wait and watch.
No, because waiting and watching only means one thing, that you will horse trade those extra eight seats. There's no other way.
You don't have to. Not necessarily. There may be good people there in Congress and JDS.
I mean, come on. Come on, you really think people vote for the goodness of their heart?
Like to, you know,
I mean,
uphold the mandate of Karnataka people.
Think, and
can
you
please?
Think,
can you? Can
no,
you
come
sorry,
on,
can
Karnataka
you
has seen your operation, Kamla.
What is good?
What are you even talking
and,
about?
And if
what
these people are good inside of the Congress, then you should have made them part of the BJP before the elections. Why wait until after, until all of this plays out?
No,
so what do you mean by good people?
Falling,
I don't understand.
Falling on the floor
no,
of the house.
No, but they didn't have place besides corrupt.
It's happened
in
96 at the center.
They didn't have space for women.
So,
they didn't have space
you know,
for
there were good people in many other parties at that time. They fell by one vote. So it's not so easy. And if there is a whip, let's again repeat it, if there's a whip, then, and plus you're not talking about, you're talking about 7 to 8 people shifting, then it can only be because of one reason, that some massive deals have taken place.
It all boils down to that. That if the BJP is asking for time, does it mean that they want time for these massive deals to take place?
I'm very sure we will win the test on the floor.
Okay, so Vinay Goyka keeps repeating the same thing, but he still hasn't offered us any clarity as to how he's going to get these extra 8 seats. We have to take a quick break here, but when we come back, we'll get into... Yes, if you want to offer me an explanation, please go ahead. Where will the 8 extra seats come from? All right, we have to take a break here, but when we come back, we'll get into what a whip really is, what it means when there is a vote on the, you know, on the floor of the House, and what the anti-defection law is and why that prevents a couple of members of one party from voting for another party and why there's a law against that. So how will the BJP get its extra 8 seats? And how much time does it want? We know that Yediyurappa asked the governor for one whole week, for 7 days. What do we expect would have happened in that 7 days? That's on the other side of this break. Don't go anywhere.